The Philippine Ombudsman rejects a lawyer's request for a copy of President Duterte's statement of assets, liabilities, and net worth. Dino De Leon, an advocate of the people's right to know and a public interest lawyer, first tried getting the salen from the office of the president last year, who referred him to the ombudsman, saying it is the proper repository of the president's salens. But the agency denied his request, referring to a 2020 memorandum circular issued by the ombudsman, or Ombudsman Samuel Martires, that requires the salen declarant's notarized letter of authorization. So what now? We are joined by Attorney Dino De Leon this morning to talk about this issue. Good morning, Attorney De Leon. Thank you for accepting our invitation.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki, and to all our viewers.
First off, were you even surprised that you were given the runaround by Malacanang and the ombudsman? The Philippine Center for Investigative Journalism tried as early as 2019 to get the president's 2018 salen to no avail. So why ask for the president's salen in the first place?
Well, of course, I wasn't surprised, right? I think various groups have already done it, aside from the PCIG. I think the Freedom of Information Coalition also has requested, and the request was denied. And of course, when I was taking a look at the guidelines as a lawyer issued by the ombudsman, I knew for a fact that it will be denied precisely because they had an unreasonable requirement for a public official to give his sworn consent for us to be able to access his salen. So if the question is, was I surprised? I wasn't surprised, but I had to do it because I had to exhaust my administrative remedies. As a citizen, I wanted to take a look at what is the wealth of our president and our public officials, did it grow in a way that cannot be explained during their stint. And then thereafter, if they will not allow me to access such kind of information, then as a lawyer, I am prepared to bring them to court.
All right. Do you believe Ombudsman Samuel Martires has legal basis to restrict the release of the salen by requiring the consent of the declarant? The administrative code does say the president's salen should be disclosed to the public.
Well, not just the administrative code. In fact, the 1987 Constitution, it is very clear in Article 11, Section 17, that it is stated there that it shall be disclosed as provided by law. In the administrative code, as you've mentioned, it is stated that it has to actually be released to the public. And in fact, in the Code of Conduct of and Ethical Standards of Public Officials, RA 6313, it is stated there clearly that the public has the right to know the assets, liabilities, and net worth of the public. Such kind, the Constitution and the laws cannot be trumped by a mere guideline issued by the ombudsman. So we have to ask ourselves, and it is quite obvious, or actually it is quite perplexing, that the first action of the ombudsman, who's supposed to be the tanod bayan of the people against corruption, is to actually prevent the people from accessing these crucial information as guaranteed by no less than the Constitution and our law. So we have to ask ourselves, what is the ombudsman doing? Is he still fulfilling his mandate? Is he still competent? You know, the ombudsman is presumably intelligent because he used to be a Supreme Court justice. I think he is deliberately doing this, and it is quite questionable that this is his first action. No, so the people should scrutinize the ombudsman. You know, the ombudsman will not be the ombudsman forever. We are aware that he is an impeachable official. He is growing old already. He's not going to be here in on earth forever. Justice will be served one way or another, but we're prepared to hold him into account in due course as well.
You said you intend to challenge the ombudsman's memorandum circular, presumably before the Supreme Court. But the Supreme Court early this year junked a petition challenging the ombudsman's memorandum circular. That petition, filed by a certain Luis Biraogo, was dismissed because there was no actual case. Biraogo's request for the Vice President Lenny Robredo Salen was only verbally denied. And the High Court also cited the doctrine of hierarchy. Of course, are you confident you can make out a case this time before the Supreme Court?
As to whether it's going to be the Supreme Court or not, we're still exploring our remedies, no? Available to us at this point in time. So it may be. What I can say, Mike, is we will do it in the proper forum, which has full jurisdiction about this particular issue. What makes this request different is the fact that there is an actual controversy. I've made two requests, and I was they gave me the chase. insofar as this information is concerned. So definitely, in this instance, it cannot be dismissed based on the ground that there is no actual case or controversy.
If and when you do get to the Supreme Court, how confident are you that the Supreme Court will eventually strike down the memorandum circular of Ombudsman Samuel Martires? Because, you know, it has ruled in the past to block attempts to secure the salen of Associate Justice Marvick Leone.
Well, definitely, I'm a lawyer, and I will always wish that the Supreme Court will rule according to our laws. They have to have a good reasoning as to why they will reject this this request, especially considering the fact that it is very, very clear in our laws. But of course, you know, the Supreme Court is a human institution. We're not naive. While we're officers of the court, we know that the Supreme Court can make mistakes, and in fact has made so many mistakes in the past, right? So that nevertheless, as an officer of the court and as a believer of in the rule of law, I will have to seek recourse to the Supreme Court. I will leave it at that, because, you know, it will reach their halls someday, and I wouldn't want to give opinions prematurely as to how the Supreme Court will actually behave in this particular instance.
But are you satisfied with the letter from the Ombudsman? Because the letter did not cite any reason for denying. It just mentioned the memorandum circular.
Well, of course, it is quite disappointing, which is why, you know, I think eventually, I think Congress should take a look at the behavior of this Ombudsman. And he is an impeachable official, and it is the mandate of Congress to take a look at how impeachable officials are fulfilling their functions. So to me, this is a form of betrayal of public trust. He is not doing his functions as an ombudsman. Rather, he is acting as the main hindrance for people to be able to promote transparency and accountability to the government. So I'm, of course, very dissatisfied with the actions of Ombudsman Martires. And eventually, I think, regardless of the administration, for this administration, kahit sa Toksabuan, I think they should assess whether or not Ombudsman Martires is still fit to continue with his duty. But definitely, if there's a change in administration, I think one of the things that must be done is to actually impeach this ombudsman, because he is he has always consistently been blocking attempts of the public to hold officials publicly accountable.
You think there is enough basis to impeach him now? And why not file a complaint against him before the House of Representatives?
We will do that eventually. Of course, in due course, we just received the denial. But of course, rest assured that the actions of Ombudsman Martires in various occasions, not just for this particular occasion, are being well documented by the public. And he will be remembered. He will be remembered. Let's say, for example, he will be held into account. But of course, he will be remembered by posterity as somebody who has not been fulfilling his functions well.
Now, what do you make of the assertions that salens have been weaponized, from the ouster of former Chief Justice Renato Corona to former Chief Justice Maria Lourdes Sereno? You said in your Facebook post that the idea of securing the president's salen came from Senator Laila de Lima. You could also be accused of by supporters of the president of trying to use the salen against the president. So how would you respond to that?
Well, you know, the salen is indeed a weapon against corrupt public officials. So whether or not it has been weaponized is beside the point. If there is justification to use it against a public official, by all means, it should be done. You know, for Senator Laila de Lima, his her salen is publicly available. The public can scrutinize it. They can request it. If they need the written consent of the senator, by all means, we're willing to provide them, because, you know, she has nothing to hide. But if these public officials have something to hide, then that's probably the reason why they wouldn't want to release their salen. You know, the public can use this as a weapon. The only problem with what they did with Chief Justice Sereno is the act of non-filing, supposedly, which was allowed by the JBC during that point in time. In fact, it's not the non-filing, but the non-existence of the salen, because the salen was raised in a fire, right? So it's quite the circumstances and the facts are not similar in this particular instance. In that particular case, Chief Justice Sereno had a salin. It wasn't available yet. It was allowed by the JBC. Here, there was just blatant refusal to actually release it to the public. So those are two different things, and they cannot conflate the issues because the issues here are clear. They are preventing the public from accessing supposedly publicly readily information.
The Supreme Court did make a factual determination in the Sereno case that supposedly the former Chief Justice did not file her salin. Do you agree with that factual determination by the Supreme Court?
Well, we can no longer do anything about that. But to begin with, the documents are very clear in that case. And the issue is not just that. But assuming that that is true, it was in fact allowed by the JBC when they were qualifying Chief Justice Sereno and as a candidate to become Supreme Court Justice. So is that particular action of the JBC, does that not have weight in that instance? So those are questions that I particularly regret the interpretation of the Supreme Court there, but what's done is done. And of course, posterity and law students and lawyers will continue to study that case when they become continuing students of the law.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, what do you make of Malacanang's denial of your request, especially in light of the President's Executive Order Number 2, which reminded public officials of their obligation to file salins and make these available for scrutiny? Have you tried going back to Malacanang to secure the notarized letter of authorization from the president?
Well, it's going to be impossible, and that's going to be part of the case. We wouldn't want to actually secure that because that is kowtowing to an unreasonable requirement of the ombudsman. So the cause of action will say that would be unreasonable because I shouldn't be getting consent of public officials just to access their salin, which is supposed to be readily available to me. In other words, I do not intend to ask once again because I already asked. And if they are really sincere in saying that, I can access it, then they could have provided their sworn statement right from the very start because they are presumably aware of the requirements of the guidelines. So Malacanang has to, I believe, as a lawyer, has a distinct duty to also disclose the these documents that are supposed to be publicly accessible once requested. And of course, Malacanang and their officials, including possibly the president, will be included in that suit.
And now the public might be asking, Attorney De Leon, why is the president's salin an important issue at this time? You know, we're in the middle of a pandemic. He is less than a year away from stepping down. Although he did accept the nomination for vice president, do you think this should be an election issue?
Well, if he accepted the nomination as vice president, then we should know what are the things that he did during his stint as a president and as a public official. Yes, this is an election issue. Corruption is an election issue. The main reason why we're not probably recovering from the pandemic is precisely because of so much corruption. Where have the COVID funds gone? Basically, and formally issued 8 billion bagong-bago yung company. The company is barely a year old when it was already bagging an 8 billion deal, and then 43 billion pesos worth of funds diverted. And that's just the onset of all of these things. And we're just talking about DOH funds. Where has the intelligence funds, for example, of the Office of the President gone, which ballooned to, 1,000% during the stint of President Duterte? There are just so many questions about corruption. So it's not just the president, but his cabinet officials, where a lot of them are running as senators, must be scrutinized by the public. So apart from all the misgivings of this administration, corruption should be the issue. If we are not going to take a look at corruption as part and parcel of our pandemic response, then there will be no incentive for them to really address the pandemic kasi kumikita sila eh. They're milking the pandemic. So, of course, they will not solve it because it's their cash cow at this point in time. So it is important for us to prevent them from their corruption activities because it will be linked as to whether or not ultimately we'll be able to solve the pandemic.
Now, lastly, I have to ask you this. You have previously tried to secure the health records of the president. You went to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court blocked it. What do you make of this administration's attitude towards freedom of information?
You know, Mike,
Attorney De Leon, we seem to have lost your audio.
Hello, hello, hello. Can you hear me?
All right, yes.
All right. You know, in any democracy, Mike, kasama lagi are checks and balances, transparency, the people's right to know. And any democracy can only work if the people are empowered with information so that they can make an intelligent decision, right? In asking the question, can the president still lead our country? We have to be able to determine, is he healthy? And again, if they have nothing to hide, why were they afraid of disclosing his health records, right? It really feels like they're hiding something, preventing the public to make an intelligent decision. In this particular instance, if they have nothing to hide, then they can just release the SALN. In other words, you know, this administration is anti-democratic because it is not transparent. It does not want to be held into account, and they don't want to give the people their ultimate weapon. And their ultimate weapon is information so that they can make an intelligent decision and withdraw their support if necessary. So I'm very disappointed about this administration. It should be it should actually not surprise all of us, but definitely transparency, accountability, the right of information, the right of the people to information should actually be part of the consideration of the people in electing the right candidates. Lastly, I would just say, no, that the biggest weapon that we have against abusive and despotic regimes would always be their sense of shame. And if they don't have, if the leader, specifically the president, has no shame, then he will not be he will not be checked by the people, because that's our main weapon, supposedly. Yung mahiya naman siya. So sana yung i-elect natin in the future, apart from the fact that we'll respect our right to information, yung may kahihiyan. And I think this president has no sense of shame.
All right, we'll have to leave it at that. Thank you for joining us this morning, Attorney Dino De Leon.
Thank you very much, Mike and Nikki, for having me.